Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh and we are going to start with our current affairs classes. So today you have 10th of April 2021, all right? And these lectures are basically are useful for those students who are preparing for the civil services examination as well as other government competitive examinations. For that purpose, you have to study or you have to read a national newspaper, like you can refer the Hindu or Indian Express. Both of these newspapers are equally good. You can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures, all right? And these lectures are basically uploaded on the YouTube. So you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube, okay, where you will get the daily current affairs related lectures on the day-to-day basis. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first is basically the news related to the religious conversions. Right. So as you know that our constitution provides the fundamental right. Right. So that is the right to have a religion, right to propagate, right to freely profess, right to practice. Right. This is basically given as a fundamental right in our constitution. So it's a fundamental right given to the citizens of this country. Right. And it is given under Article 25 to 28 in part third of the constitution. So part third, which is basically related to the fundamental rights, okay, under Article 25 to 28, basically given the right to religion or right to freedom of religion. Okay, now it is been fundamental right. The fundamental right means if they are violated, the people have right to move directly to the Supreme Court for their enforcement, right? And Supreme Court under Article 32 is under obligation to issue the writs for the purpose of enforcement of these violated fundamental rights. So right to freedom of the religion is basically fundamental right. Okay. It is being given under Article 25 to 28, which provide that the constitution provide the fundamental right to freely profess, practice and propagate the religion and its principles. Okay. But there are certain restrictions. For example, you have to have the restrictions which are subjected to the public order, morality, and the health. Okay. So what happens is there are certain issues related to the religious conversions. Okay. For example, if you visit in the tribal areas, okay, there are Christian missionaries who are converting the tribals, poor tribals. There is news, right? And many states are also, you know, framing the laws. Many states have already made the laws related to anti-conversions or anti-religious conversions law. Okay, so they have made it into a statute book. Okay, so the purpose is ultimately to stop these religious conversions based on some economic lure, because some are basically poor people, these tribal people or the lower caste people. Okay, they are poor and right, the because of some sort of a, you know, the economic incentive they are providing, right, for the purpose of they are basically converting the religion from basically Hinduism, or, you know, from majority from the Hinduism to basically Christianity. There are some news related to the Muslim conversions also. Okay. And this is what is happening, right, as the news basically coming out. Okay. Now, the Supreme Court also says that, right, that like constitution provide the fundamental right, right, to every citizen, to the people of this country, to freely to choose their religion, right, to freely profess, practice and propagate the religion. Okay. And, you know, a basically petition which is filed, right, in the Supreme Court, basically it says that there are the conversions which are going on in our country, right, the mass religious conversions are going on. Okay, the Supreme Court, you know, put heavily and less doubt on this petition, which is claiming that the mass religious conversions have been going on, right, across our country. So the Supreme Court says that the people under Article 25 to 28 have been provided the fundamental right under the constitution, right, to freely profess, practice, to propagate the religion, okay, any religion, whichever the person or whichever the citizen would like to do. So Article 25 also provide that constitutional right, or sorry, fundamental right to freely profess, practice and propagate any religion. Okay, now according to the Supreme Court, right, if, right, if that propagation of the basic religious tenets, right, it should not be for the purpose of conversion, right? So the freely profess, practice and propagation of any religious conversion, any religious, you know, tenets should not be for the purpose of conversion, right? It should be for the basic principles. And for that purpose, the person is the final judge of his choice of religion, right? So the court, according to the Supreme Court, the court cannot sit a judge for the purpose of, right, the decision which have been taken by the person. It is a personal choice. It is a personal choice, right? It is a private sphere of life of a person, right, to which religion he or she would like to profess, okay? And as well as his life partner. So the court has no right, or court has no power to intervene in that. The court cannot sit in the judgment of a person's choice for the freely choosing any sort of a religion, okay? And the Supreme Court also says that the religious faith is basically a part of fundamental right to privacy, which have been also been recognized as a fundamental right. Okay, already the Supreme Court, bench have already upheld the inviolability of the right to privacy. Okay, this right to privacy have been equated with the right to life, with dignity and the liberty. This is what the most important aspect have been given by the Supreme Court. So here, the person who is above 18 years or above, right, whether he can choose a particular religion or not, right? So obviously, the Supreme Court says that what kind of petition it is, right? Right? We will impose heavy cost on you if you have filed any sort of a wrong petition on behalf on us, right? Either you withdraw it or argue, or the risk of the consequences by wasting our time in the precious time, specifically in the Supreme Court complex. All right. Next, the freedom of navigation operation. Right now, what is happening is that I'll tell you the background. One U.S. ship, that is USS John Paul Jones, which is basically U.S. Navy ship. Now, this U.S. Navy ship have ventured into the India's exclusive economic zone. So, this exclusive economic zone is basically up to 200 nautical miles. Okay, that is up to 200 nautical miles from shore. From the show, right? So this area up to 200 nautical miles is basically belong to India. What is exclusive economic zone, right? If any foreign country ship, right, if it is venturing into the exclusive economic zone of a particular country, the particular country have to take the permission from the host country whose exclusive economic zones are falling in that particular area. Without their permission, they cannot enter into the exclusive economic zone. Okay, so this is as per the international convention. Okay, so that is, should be followed by every country, right? It is basically, simply an international law. So what happens is, in that background, one U.S. ship, the USS John Paul Jones, recently conducted patrol in the Western Indian Ocean. So it is basically entered into the India's exclusive economic zone, which falls up to the 200 nautical miles from the shore. Okay, now the Ministry of External Affairs claim that the US ship has entered into the basically exclusive economic zones, and it has violated the domestic maritime law, which is basically the simply violation of the international law, right? So US Navy ship or US Navy have recently been announced a statement that the USS John Paul Jones, which is a ship name or US Navy ship name, have carried out this freedom of navigation operation. So this freedom of navigation operation will be carried out in Indian Ocean region, but India claimed that it has ventured inside the India's exclusive economic zone. So this is what is something is the most important, and that operation had challenged what the US called the India's excessive maritime claims. So US is saying that it is an excessive maritime claims which have been claimed by India. Okay, but India has maintained that it is as per the international law. We have clearly demarcated our exclusive economic zones, and the country ship whoever is entering into our exclusive economic zones should have to take the prior permission before entering into the exclusive economic zone. Okay, now USS John Paul Jones, which is a basically US Navy ship, have asserted that the navigational rights and the freedom approximately 130 nautical miles from the Lakshadweep Islands, right, is consistent with the international law. Now you must understand how it is consistent with the international law, because the US's John Paul Jones claimed that it is basically consistent, so we did not have to take the permission, and it is without requesting the India's prior consent, it is as per the international law. But I let you know that United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, that is UNCLOS, basically provide a convention, right, that basically govern this type of issues. So here, any sort of a country does not authorize, right, you know, to carry out in exclusive economic zones, right, without the permission, right? So that country have to take the permission, right, if the country is venturing into the continental shelf or any sort of a military exercise maneuvers, right, or any sort of a, you know, the involvement of the weapons or explosive, that country cannot enter without the consent of the coastal state. So that is as per the UNCLOS law. So if the country is entering into the EEZ, right, the UNCLOS clearly says that the country should have to take the prior permission from basically the host country, that is the coastal state. And one more important point here, you must understand, India has already ratified this UNCLOS, that is United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, but US has failed to do so far. That means US has not, you know, basically, you know, ratified this law. So that is the reason the US is basically failed to take the prior consent from the India and just directly ventured into the India's exclusive economic zones, right? And this is what is something is most, you know, the problematic part from the US so far, right? Being a, you know, responsible democratic country, you know, the US should not do. And US is also having a friendly relationship with the India. So obviously for having the, you know, have faith in the relationship, it should have not done so far. Okay. So, you know, so the Ministry of External Affairs says that USS John Paul Jones was continuously monitored the transition when it was moving from the Persian Gulf towards the Malacca Strait. Now, the Ministry of External Affairs says that we have conveyed our concern regarding passage of this ship from our exclusive economic zones, right, to the government of USA through appropriate diplomatic channels. All right. Next, 2001 Mars Odyssey. Now, you must understand, what is this Mars Odyssey? The Mars Odyssey is nothing but a spacecraft. It has sent to the Mars, right, around 20 years back, that is on 2001. Okay, it is basically the oldest spacecraft, right, is still working, right, in the red planet, that is called Mars. It is the oldest spacecraft. So this spacecraft was sent to the Mars by the NASA, which is a USA's premier, you know, space agency, in 2001. That is the around 20 years for the purpose of mapping this red planet, right? So it was launched on, you know, around, you know, April 7th, 2001. That is around, you know, 20 years back. And it is the oldest spacecraft still working at the red planet. Okay. Now, it also consists the orbiter. Okay. Now, this name for the Mars Odyssey have been named, on behalf of the Arthur C. Clarke, classic sci-fi novel 2001. That novel named as The Space Odyssey. Okay. So this name of the spacecraft is basically came from this novel, that is science fiction novel for 2001 that was published. Okay. And it was sent for the composition to map the composition of the Martian surface, right? Whether what type of, you know, the surface it is, whether the water availability is there or not, right? Is what type of minerals and all sort of things are found on the surface of Mars. Okay. Now, the scientists basically belong to USA's or NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory. Mr. the Jeffrey Polt have recently said that before Odyssey, right? All right. So here, the most important is that the NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory scientist Jeffrey Polt have recently said that, you know, before Odyssey, which was sent in 2001, we did not have the clue, right, whether there was water on the surface of the planet or not. We did not have any clue. Okay. Now, this, the Space Odyssey, which has been sent to the surface of the Mars, right, is also doing certain experiment of trying to have the feasibility of human traveling to the Mars, right? Obviously, we will have the more focus of, right, you know, of the instruments which have been attached with the Odyssey. Now, this is what is something like measuring how much the space radiation astronauts will be have to be contained before it was stopped working in 2003. Okay. And the most complete global maps of the Mars that was made using this Odyssey's infrared camera, that is called the Thermal Emission Imaging System, that is called THEMIS. Okay, that is, you know, the global map of the Mars that is being made with the help of the camera or infrared camera, which is being attached with the Odyssey. So that is the thermal map or global thermal map or global map for the Mars that is called the Thermal Emission Imaging System, that is also called THEMIS, that is called camera, which is being attached or which is being fixed with the Odyssey, right? So obviously it is being used for, you know, for the mapping of the surface of the Mars. Okay, so this is a picture for the Odyssey. So you can say it is having the high gain antenna. Okay, it is basically, you know, the MERI, which is located inside. It is high energy neutron detector. Okay, it is also one of the antenna, right? It is what the THEMIS, that is, you know, the previously I was talking about the camera, right? And it is the neutron spectrometer, then gamma sensor head, which has been attached with that, the battery for the purpose, and the solar array for taking off the energy, right? Next, the impact of climate change on the biodiversity. Now you must understand, right, as you know that the climate change is very drastic, right, because of anthropogenic regions, right? Now, because of anthropogenic regions, the climate change is, you know, accelerated, right? Now, this climate change has also adversely impacting the humans, but also, right, the all ecosystems, right? So it's all flora and the fauna, all are adversely affected because of, you know, the adverse climatic change that is happening. Okay, now many floral and the faunal species have now gone in, going to extinct, and many have already gone to extinct. Okay, now a recent study which is published in a journal called Biological Conservation have recently claimed that, recently will claim that, that the world most scenic natural places, which is having many animals and the plants, right, are facing the extinction, right? If the greenhouse gas emissions continue to rise. What is greenhouse gas emissions? The greenhouse gas emissions are basically consisting of the nitrous oxide, okay? Then you have your basically carbon dioxide, okay? Then you have your methane. These are considered as a greenhouse gas. It is because of the greenhouse effect, because these covers or these basically gases are basically covered the surface of the earth and increases the temperature, because these gases basically captured the terrestrial radiation. This is called terrestrial radiation. Okay, so these terrestrial radiation are basically captured by these gases, right? So these are the gases. Now these gases act as a blanket. You are getting my point? These gases act as a blanket and keep the surface of the earth warm enough to have, you know, the some form of life on the surface, as well as it will also regulate the surface temperature of the earth. Now consider, if that blanket given more thick and more dense, what will happen? More amount of the molecules of the greenhouse gas will be there, more absorption of the temperature, more absorption of the heat will be there. More absorption of the heat means the temperature will be rising, the temperature will also rise. So what will happen ultimately, the more is the and greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, the more is the temperature, because it will increase the heat absorption capacity, because these greenhouse gases are basically absorbing the terrestrial radiation which is being radiated from the surface of the earth. I'm talking about the terrestrial radiation. You remember terrestrial? Terrestrial means the radiation which have been released from the surface of the earth, right? Okay. Now the key findings of this journal is that the planet heats by over 3 degrees Celsius, right? If the planet heats, that means if the temperature heats to over 3 degrees Celsius, right, as compared to the pre-industrial level, right, the journal says that there will be third of the endemic species living on the land, right, completely faces extinction, right, as well as half of the endemic species which are living in the sea also faces extinction. That means almost 30% of the endemic species which is living on the land, right, will be extinct or will face extinction, right, as well as 50% of the endemic species which are living in the sea will also face extinction as per this general. Now, this general also says that specifically in the mount, specifically, you know, in the mountainous areas, right? 84% of the endemic animals as well as the plants, 84% would face the extinction. And this general also says that, right, on the islands, because islands are also verge on the extinction, verge on the, you know, submergence also. Because as the temperature will increase, what will happen? There will be, you know, the glaciers will melt, the ice will melt. And what will happen? The sea surface temperature, sea surface level will high. So sea surface level will increase, and ultimately what will happen? There will be submergence of the island. And the general predict that there will be 100%, right, extinction of the species belong to flora and the fauna on the islands, right? So that will be the huge loss, right? And the journal also says that the endemic species are mostly threatened by the climatic change. It will also affect the lemurs, which is basically found unique to the Madagascar, which is an island, right? It is also says that the snow leopard will also face extinction if the climate change would help, because that will basically melt the snow, specifically in the Himalayan region, right? The journal further says that the most important medicinal plants such as Lichen laboria pindarensis, which is basically used to alleviate arthritis, would also faces threat, right? Because such adverse climatic change would be, you know, adversely affecting the growth of these medicinal plants. Okay, we have our Paris Agreement that was basically signed among the world countries. Now, this goal of the Paris Agreement is basically to stop or to make the global temperature rise well below 2 degrees Celsius. Ideally, it should be 1.5 degrees Celsius compared to baseline, that is pre-industrial level. Okay, so that is the goal. But whether we are able to restrict our temperature to well below 2 degrees Celsius, it's a doubtful, because many countries have not been, you know, cooperating here, and they have not reduced their greenhouse gas emissions, right? And it will be very difficult to say whether the global temperature will be well below 2 degrees Celsius, because that is how something which is going to happen, right? And we don't know about what will be the exact effect on the species, but definitely if we have to save our majority of the species, we have to restrict our temperature to well below 2 degrees Celsius, right, as compared to the baseline, that is pre-industrial level. So it is lemurs, how beautiful they are. Okay, then online dispute resolution. Now you must understand, right, the Niti Aayog is basically promoting the online dispute resolution framework specifically, right, to, you know, to the business leaders. Because now what is happening is that there are a lot of disputes, and these disputes are basically pending or languishing in the courts, in the court of the law. And that is ultimately, you know, take the precious chunk of the time belongs to the court. Okay. And these disputes are languishing, you know, years together. So the Niti Aayog is planning, or Niti Aayog is forwarding, you know, or promoting this online dispute resolution. The idea of this online dispute resolution is basically to focus on, you know, the online dispute resolution mechanism specifically for the small amount or for the medium amount, right? So the Niti Aayog, in association with the Agami and OMDR network, that is India, with the support of ICICI Bank as well as the Ashoka Innovators, have launched the first of its kind, the online dispute resolution handbook in India. Okay, now this handbook is basically an invitation to the various business leaders to adopt the online dispute resolution mechanism, right? And such mechanism, right, can adopt, right, will have definitely an actionable pathway for them. Okay. And as I told you that the online dispute resolution mechanism is definitely outside the court. So it is a dispute resolution which is outside the court, right? So it is an out of court resolution, particularly for the medium and the small values cases, because you must understand, unnecessarily for the medium and the small values cases, we are basically, you know, calling, or we are basically going to the court of the law and necessarily bringing these cases altogether. So if we could use this digital technology, right, the techniques of alternative dispute resolution mechanism, right, such that we can have the negotiations we can have the mediations, we can have the arbitrations. So negotiations, mediations, and the arbitration, these processes can be adopted out of the court. Okay. And that will be beneficial for the resolution of those disputes, which are small and the medium value cases. Okay. And as you know that the courts are also become digitized through the effort which are made by the judiciary, specifically the Supreme Court and the High Courts, right? And there are also the more effective and collaborative mechanism, right, of such type of resolutions, containments, right, which are urgently needed, right, for the purpose of resolution of such disputes. And this online dispute resolution can help resolve the disputes effectively and affordably, right, without any further delay. All right, next, the post-matric scholarship scheme for the scheduled caste. Okay, so post-matric scholarship scheme is being provided specifically to the scheduled caste students, right, for the purpose of higher education. So the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, which is the parent ministry for such scholarship, have reviewed recently the progress which have been made in this post-matric scholarship scheme specifically for the scheduled caste in the last financial year. Okay, now the government of India has revamped this post-matric scholarship scheme for the scheduled caste. Okay, that is to provide this scholarship scheme as a universal, right, access to, you know, to basically, you know, to the SCUs specifically for the purpose of their higher education, right? This is what is something the government of India is also providing, right? The funding pattern for this post-matric scholarship scheme for the scheduled caste have also been changed or also been revamped. So initially the previous formula, that was the liability formula, right, have been changed to the fixed sharing formula. So now the fixed sharing formula is that out of 100%, that is the fund that is needed, okay, for the purpose of this post-matric scholarship, 60% funds will come from the center. The center will provide the 60% fund, 40% funds will provide by the states. Okay, that is the fixed. In case of Northeastern state, 90% fund will be provided by the center and 10% fund will be provided by the states. That is a fixed sharing pattern which have been decided by the government of India, and that will definitely increase the commitment from the government, specifically in the schemes that will increase to the four times or to the fourfold. Okay, this year or this financial year, you know, till 2025-26, the government of India has committed 35,534 crore rupees, right? So central government has committed this 35,000 crore rupees, right, for this scheme till 2025-26, right? And it is estimated that from this post-matric scholarship scheme, around 4 crore youths will get benefited, right, and during that period. Okay, and as you know that is that it, this sharing, fixed sharing pattern has also increased the central share for the scheme. And the government is also trying, have already been brought the several process improvement to avoid any further delay, specifically in the payment of the scholarship using the DBT system, that is direct benefit transfer. Direct benefit transfer. All right. Next, the nano sniffer. What is that nano sniffer? So nano sniffer is nothing but the explosive track detector device, right? So it is simple. It is a detector device that can track any explosive found. So it is a, first of all, it is the homemade, that is, it is a completely indigenously built and manufactured such, you know, the explosive track detector device. So Union Education Minister, Mr. Ramesh Pokhriyal Nishank, launched the nano sniffer, which is the world first micro sensor based explosive track device detector. It is the world first micro sensor based device. Okay. And as I told you that it is the homegrown explosive track detector device. That means it is manufactured by India. It is built in India. Okay. And it can detect the explosives in less than 10 seconds. So it will take hardly 10 seconds because it's based on the micro sensor based track detector device. It can also identify and categorize the explosives into different classes, right? Which will also be useful for the purpose of, for the purpose of neutralizing such type of explosives at which much faster pace, right? So it detects basically all classes of, the explosive, be it a military class, conventional or the homemade explosives. right? And this nano sniffer, which is a world first micro sensor based explosive tracking device, will give viable and audible alerts, right? Which will, for the purpose of sunlight readable color display. All right. Next, the nano sniffer is 100% made in India, right? It's a 100% made in India product in terms of the research and the development and manufacturing. Okay. It has been developed by the IIT Bombay, that is, you know, developed by a technology that is called nano stiff technologies, which is basically the startup which was started by the IIT Bombay. So it is a IIT Bombay incubative startup that is called nano stiff. So that is called nano sniff technologies. And this, you know, device have been recently been marketed by the Behent Technologies, which is nothing but the spin-off from a IIT Delhi incubated startup that is called Critical Solutions. So Critical Solutions basically provide the marketing, you know, platform for such, you know, the nano, this, you know, detector device, as well as it has been developed by the IIT Bombay, you know, startup, right? And it will be an affordable device that will definitely reduce the India's dependence on the imported explosive track detector device that India is currently importing from the Western countries, right? So it is a nano sniffer which can basically track or which can basically detect the explosive in just 10 seconds, all right? And it will be beneficial for the purpose of the any sort of a detection for the purpose of, you know, such type of explosive, either military, conventional, or homemade. Okay, next, the pre-packaged insolvency resolution process. Now you must understand, the government of India has already promulgated, right, the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code Amendment Ordinance 2021, right? The president has the power to promulgate the ordinance based on the recommendation which is given by the cabinet. Okay, now this ordinance provides the pre-packaged insolvency resolution process. Obviously, this pre-packaged insolvency resolution process, right, process for the corporate debtors, which are also classified as the micro, small, and the medium enterprises. Okay, now the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India, which is a basically the nodal board, right, which have already been notifying this Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India pre-packaged insolvency process resolution 2021, right, which will basically enable, right, this pre-packaged insolvency resolution process, right? And this pre-process insolvency resolution process is basically regulations provide the details of, you know, all sort of forms that stakeholders are required to use. Okay, and it will also provide the framework, the manner in which it will carry out the various tasks, right, as a part of this pre-packaged insolvency resolution process, right? And the details and the manner related to in some sort of a pre-packaged insolvency resolution process are basically, it will provide the eligibility to act as a resolution professional, as well as the terms of appointment, right? So it has, right, for the purpose of resolution professionals, for the purpose of, you know, resolution, such type of resolution professional will have the eligibility that will also be provided by such ordinance, right? It will also provide the eligibility for registered valuers and other professionals, right? It will also have, you know, the identification, the selection of authorized representatives, okay? And it will also have, you know, the public announcement and the claims of the stakeholders, right? It will also have the information memorandum, okay? It will also have the details regarding the committee of creditors, as well as the meeting of these creditors, right? It will also have the resolution plans, their details, as well as the invitation for the resolution plans, right? It will also have the base resolution plan. It will also have the mechanism for choosing this best resolution plan, right? It will also have the mechanism for the competition among these base resolution plans. It will also evaluate these resolution plans. It will also consider these resolution plans, right? And it will also have the management of the corporate debtors, which is resolution professionals. And it will also have the, you know, the process of the termination of this, you know, this, you know, PPIRP, that is the pre-packaged insolvency resolution process. All right. So it will basically help in, you know, basically your corporate debtors, which are basically also in the need of such resolution. Okay. Next, the Harichand Thakur. Now you must understand who is Harichand Thakur. The Harichand Thakur was basically untouchable that belongs to the Bengal Presidency. Okay, now the worth anniversary of Harichand Thakur that was there, right? The Prime Minister Narendra Modi have paid the homage to Harichand Thakur, who was basically untouchable, who belongs to the Bengal Presidency, right? He basically formed the Mathua sect of Hindus. Okay, regarding Mathua sect, the Mathua Mahasangha or Mathua sect is basically the religious for reformation movement that was started by basically your Harichand Thakur. Okay, the Harichand Thakur basically started this Mathua Mahasangha around 1860 AD in the Bengal, right? And the considerable followers of this Mathua sect or Mathua Mahasangha, right, are basically belong to Bangladesh as well as in the West Bengal, right? The Mathua is basically a sect of Vaishnavite Hinduism, right, which is basically, you know, considered as a Nama Sudras, right? These Nama Sudras are basically a scheduled caste group. So Mathua sect of the West, Mathua sect is basically nothing but a sect of the Vaishnavite Hindus who are nothing but the Nama Sudras. The Nama Sudras are basically the scheduled caste groups, right? Or people belongs to the scheduled caste in the Bengal as well as in the Bangladesh region. So the Prime Minister Narendra Modi have paid recently his homage to the Jayanti of, right, Harichand Thakur, who was basically an untouchable, belongs to the Bengal Presidency. All right. So you can see here, he was basically, right, the Harichand Thakur, who was basically untouchable and who has basically started this Mathua sect. Right. All right. Then India Netherlands virtual summit. Now virtual summit means it is basically held in the on the basically on the virtual platform on the internet. Okay. So recently elections or general elections basically held in the Netherlands. And after that, the newly elected prime minister, who is basically, you know, called the PM Rutte, right? The PM Rutte is basically, you know, elected to basically as a prime minister of Netherlands, right, for the fourth consecutive term. So Prime Minister Narendra Modi, as well as the basically, you know, the prime minister of the Netherlands, Mark Rutte, have held this virtual summit. Okay. At this high level summit, both of these leaders exchange, first of all, various, you know, the bilateral as well as, you know, other cooperation issues. The Prime Minister Narendra Modi basically congratulated the newly elected Prime Minister, Mr. Rutte, who has recently won the election, which was held in March 2021, right? And he has elected for the fourth consecutive term. That means he is basically, he will be the Prime Minister for the fourth consecutive term, right, as the Prime Minister of Netherlands, right? So both of these leaders basically exchange the views on further expanding their relationship, specifically the India and Netherlands relationship in the trade and the economy, water management, in the agriculture, in the smart cities, in the science and technology, in the healthcare and the space. So they want to make this you know, relationship as much as exhaustive to cover the more and more subjects into the ambit of such bilateral relationship, right, in order to expand further, right? And the two prime minister, that is Prime Minister Narendra Modi as well as the Prime Minister Rutte of the Netherlands, both have agreed on the institution of the strategic partnership on the water, right? That strategic partnership on the water would further provide the avenue for the Indo-Dutch cooperation in the water related sector, right? And it has already been decided that the joint working group that is basically working on the water will be upgraded to the joint ministerial labor group. So that will be upgraded instead of the joint working group, it will be upgraded to the joint ministerial labor group between India and the Netherlands. Okay. And the Prime Minister Narendra Modi also thanked the Netherlands, which have recently been extended their support to the International Solar Alliance, as well as the Netherlands also extended support to the Coalition for the Disaster Resilience Infrastructure, right? And the Prime Minister Narendra Modi also welcomed the Netherlands Indo-Pacific policy, right, which provide the much needed developmental avenues for the Indo-Pacific region. All right, so you can see this is the map. So Netherlands, okay, the capital is Amsterdam. You can see it is basically lying right to the shore nearby to the North Sea. The neighboring countries are Germany, Belgium, right, which are basically some of the neighboring countries, and this is the map you can see in your atlas also. All right, so thank you very much. That's all for the today. We will meet again tomorrow for our current affairs. Thank you very much.